Praise God. What a joy it is to be with you. Would you believe it? This is my first time in this part of Canada. It's a wonderful country and above all, wonderful people like you. Do you hear the echo? Or is it just me? Is this okay now? Before we begin, I want to introduce to you, of course, most important, my life partner of 45 years. Honey, baby, will you please stand up? And then our co-worker, Danny Perez and his wife, Grace, will you please stand up? We have known each other, Danny, Jim, over 30 years. It's amazing how Danny has remained the same. Very humble. Danny, I'm so glad you are here helping the North American believers. I'm excited with what God is doing. I'm so blessed with the testimony, with all that's happening. Do you believe that everybody wants to make a difference? Yes or no? A survey was made among millennials and the younger generations. They really don't care much about money, even though money is important. But they want to live a life of significance, a life that's meaningful. Now, before I share with you how to make a difference, I'm going to give you a secret. You all know what happened this weekend, last week. Two famous celebrities committed suicide. One is Anthony Bourdain, and the other one is Kate. Now, I was just reading something about them, especially about Anthony. Somebody said that the magazine and the newspaper said he lived the ideal life. He said he has the most ideal job in the world. He got everything. Money, fame, you name it. But why did he kill himself? How I wish I can tell everybody that there is really a God-shaped vacuum in the heart of everybody. There is that God-shaped vacuum that can only be filled, not by any created thing, money, fame. It's not going to fill that. We were created by God for God. So the only way to fill that up, you got to meet Jesus. Before we begin, I want you to meet my family. Would you like to meet my family? All right. What do you notice about my children? You notice they don't look like me. They look like my wonderful wife. Now, my five wonderful children are all happily married. All happily married. Oh, what's happening? Okay. You see spouses. And two of them used to be in the States. One has gone back to the Philippines. And the other one, my daughter, is a dentist, married to a dentist. And they are practicing their career in Sacramento. They tried to practice in the Philippines. Except the Philippine government does not give you license for people with U.S. citizens. You have to be a Filipino to practice. So that's sad. So after 1 year, they went back to Sacramento. And would you believe it? Do you know how many grandchildren I have? Okay. I have obeyed the Bible. When God says, go and multiply, I have fulfilled the command. Praise God. And one is on the way. Surprise, surprise, surprise. So we will now be 20 by December. To God be the glory. That's my family. Folks, have you ever been disappointed? How many of you have been disappointed? Raise your hand. You know what disappoints us? Think about it. How many of you have never been disappointed? Raise your hand. I'd like to meet you. We get disappointed. If you're single, perhaps you experience disappointment with relationships. If you're married, people get married with the idea of, I will live happily ever after. Am I correct? Now, how many of you are singles? What about me? Singles. Come on, singles. You are my friend. Singles. Singles, what about me now? Someday you will get married or you plan to get married. I know why you want to get married. You know why you want to get married? Because in your mind, when you get married, you will be happy. Of course, nobody gets married to be miserable. Those of you who are married, raise your hands. Those of you who are married, higher, higher. Now, singles, just ask those guys, okay? And they will tell you the truth. But kidding aside, my wife and I have been married for 45 years, and we are still in our honeymoon. And that's one of the reasons why I tell people I believe in Jesus. It takes Jesus to build an amazing family. And I'm not the only one. Danny Perez, Jim, we have thousands of people who have experienced the reality of Jesus. But let me share with you how we get disappointed. The reality is this. All of us have expectations. Whether you like it or not, you have expectations. When you go to work, when you land a job, you have expectations. You'll be promoted. You will make so much money. All of us have expectations. The problem is this. Your current reality, your current experiences and expectations do not match. When they don't match, that's equal to disappointment. Now, the sad thing is this. Some people are also disappointed with God. Remember our sharer? She shared about how when the baby died, stillborn, you have certain expectations. If you are not careful, you get I'm disappointed with the sound system. You get disappointed with the Lord. And when you get disappointed with God, you may not know this. It's dangerous if you don't know how to process it. But can I tell you something? If you are disappointed with God, you talk to Him. You tell Him, I'm going to teach you how to deal with disappointment. Would you like to learn? If ever there is one, this, if I turn this way, can you hear me? If you don't learn how to deal with disappointment, my concern is you will not remain vibrant in your faith. From disappointment, if you're not careful, you get discouraged. If you're not careful, you get depressed. And if you get depressed, many times people commit suicide. Because for them, death is a better option. Without realizing that is not the way of the Lord. I've dealt with these issues for many years. And I praise God, there is a solution. If I can broadcast this to the whole world, I can show them countless examples how depressed people can get out of this. It's not complicated. It's simple. Would you like to learn how? You share this with your friends. Theology is important. If you don't understand theology, you don't know how to deal with disappointment. So everybody, let's read these verses together, if you don't mind. Together. Consider it all joy, my brethren, when you encounter various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces endurance, and let endurance have its perfect result, so that you may be perfect, complete, lacking in nothing. You notice, it is not natural for people to consider it all joy when we are in trouble. It depends on your theology. It depends on your perspective. The Bible, see, I'm getting disappointed. But don't worry. Consider it all joy. Notice, all joy. My goodness, why will I be happy when I have problems? The reason is this. Read. Knowing that the testing of your faith produces endurance, and let endurance have its perfect result, that you may be perfect, complete in nothing. What I'm learning in life is simply this. God is more concerned with my character than with my comfort. And as I look back in my life, all the important lessons I have learned is not when everything is okay with me. It's when things are not okay, somehow God speaks. As C.S. Lewis once said, pain is the megaphone of God. God whispers in our pleasure, but He shouts in our pain. Meaning, when you're in pain, you become more sensitive to what God is saying. So, ladies and gentlemen, when you have trials, what do? It's not easy to be joyful. I'm not asking you to go to a funeral parlor today, and when you see somebody grieving, hey, you better be joyful. The Bible says, rejoice. Your husband is dead. That's not what the Bible is saying. What the Bible is saying is this. For your own sake, you need to learn to process disappointment. Because God has a purpose. And what is God's purpose? To produce something in your life. Now, you may not know what it is at that time. I want to share with you lots of stories from the Bible and my own stories. But look at the next example of theology. Let's look at Peter. What can we learn from Peter? Everybody, please read. In this you rejoice, everybody, even though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been distressed by various trials. Before we continue, notice, you greatly rejoice. You notice something about the Bible? It's counterintuitive. It's different from the way you and I think. The Bible says when you have problems, consider it what? Joy. My goodness. Why is that so? How do you develop that kind of theology? Understand? Let's continue reading. One more time. In this you greatly rejoice, even though for a little while. Notice, a little while. I like you to emphasize that word. Little while. Everybody. The meaning of little while is little while. Meaning, it's not forever. When you look at life from the perspective of the big picture, from the perspective of eternity, your life on earth is a little while. In this little while, your pain is not always forever. The central aspect of the Christian life is joy. It's center. Peripheral is pain. God allows pain. But central to our life is pleasure, joy from the Lord. But He allows what? Pain. But in the big picture, God is saying, I will allow certain pain. For what purpose? Do you know the purpose? Look at this verse. Everybody read. That the proof of your faith, being more precious than gold, which is perishable, even though tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Revelation of Jesus Christ is future tense. In the meantime, that the proof of your faith. What does that mean? There are many people who think they are Christians. All they have is religion. Let me repeat. Today, we are not going to waste time. CCF will never waste time converting people to a religion. Discipleship is not about religion. Discipleship is a personal, intimate relationship with Jesus so that you allow Jesus to be the center of your life, to help you make decisions, and to allow His power to flow in and through you. And that can only be done if you are. How do you know you are a real follower of Jesus? How do you know? When the rubber hits the road, when there is testing, you will find out. Let me repeat. How do you know you are a real follower of Jesus? Of course, the answer is you say by faith. How do you know your faith is real? In the midst of trial, how do you respond? That's what Peter is saying. Why is that precious? Because in the midst of trial, when you fail, at least you can say, you know what? I need to check my faith. See, God does not want you to discover at the end of your life that you are fake. He wants you to realize now whether you are fake or not, because God wants you to be genuine. So what is genuine faith? Genuine faith is trusting God because you know Him. You cannot force anybody to trust anybody until that person knows the person. Let me repeat. How can I tell my wife, trust me, if my wife does not know me? How can I ask you to trust God if you don't know God? I'm going to teach you today something about the Lord so that you will learn how to trust Him completely, and then you will learn how in the midst of trial you can trust Him. Would you like to learn? Because the objective is very important, so that your faith will be proven, that the proof of your faith being more precious than gold. My goodness, you know, people love genuine stuff. I was in a third world country and I saw the sign. They were selling watches. The sign says, genuine counterfeit. Amazing, genuine counterfeit. They were selling Rolex. Genuine counterfeit. Well, are there such genuine counterfeit Christian? Well, I tell you, I'm very sad. Lots of them in the Philippines. Why do I say in the Philippines? Philippines is supposed to be a Christian nation. Many people go to church building and worship. But we are also number one in graft and corruption. I heard we are now number three. Maybe somebody bribed somebody. Joking only, joking, okay. America is supposed to be a Christian nation. I don't know. Canada is supposed to be a Christian nation. I really don't know. When divorce rate is the same within and without, and immorality, teenage pregnancy in the Philippines is skyrocketing. HIV is the one of those few countries that's still growing. I wonder whether they understand what Christianity is all about. That's why I'm burdened. I'm burdened to teach people true Christianity. Because true Christianity is not in the head. It's in the heart. When you humble yourselves and you say, Lord Jesus, I need you. You died on the cross for my sins. I need you. Until you reach that point where you humble yourselves and say, you cannot save yourself, only Jesus, you will not know Him. So are you ready to learn how to turn disappointment into what? Blessings. One more time, everybody. Turn disappointment into, share with you biblical principles so that you will not just survive, you will thrive. In the midst of pain and suffering, you will thrive, not just survive. Ladies and gentlemen, let me give you a couple of observations about disappointment. Number one, it is inevitable. Misery is optional. Disappointment is unavoidable, inevitable. But whether you are miserable or not depends on how you respond. Somebody shared this with me years ago. 10% of life is what happens to you. Meaning it's outside your control, 10%. What is within your control is 90%. Let me repeat. What happens to you? Sickness, financial tragedy, you lose your job. Many times these are outside your control. Accidents, sickness. However, how you respond to those tragedies, to those disappointments, are within your control. And that is what you must assume responsibility. So, how do you do it? Are you ready? What's my title today? Turn disappointment into blessings. What must you do? Trust God. How do you trust God if you don't know God? First, let me explain to you the importance of trusting God. Everybody, let's read Proverbs 3, 7, 6 together. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge Him, and He will make your path straight. Let me explain. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. What does that mean? There are times when you don't fully understand. The Bible says when you don't understand, keep trusting. Do not lean on your own understanding, because your own understanding is very finite. It's very limited. So, trust Him with all your heart. Notice, not mind. Because the mind sometimes cannot understand. Honestly, many things have happened to me. I don't understand. I say, Lord, I just trust You. Help me understand. Someday, He will make you understand. In all your ways, everybody, read this. In all your ways, acknowledge Him. And He will make your path straight. What does that mean? To acknowledge Him simply means, Lord, I know You are involved. I know You are present. In all your ways, acknowledge Him. It does not mean that suddenly all your problems will be over. But it says, He will make your path straight. Meaning, He's going to help you. He's going to help you go through life. Do you need help? I don't know about you. But many times when people are sad, when people are depressed, it's not the lecture that's going to comfort them. You know what will comfort you? Many times, it's the presence of the Lord. And when you experience God's presence, I don't know how to explain this. You experience peace. For many people, Christianity is theoretical. And that is a sad thing about America, Canada, Philippines. Because we are so used to Christianity, it has become a culture. It is no longer an experience. While the first century believers experienced Jesus, experienced God, it's real. It's not theoretical. So what I'd like you guys to do is to join CCF as a movement of connecting people to the reality of who is Jesus. It is experiential, not just theoretical. They fall in love with Jesus. Their lives are transformed. From a messy life, from a chaotic life, they realize the power of Christ to transform lives. Would you like to join this movement? Yes or no? I'm asking you, but how can you join when you have not experienced this? All right? Let me give you a story. It's found in the Gospel of John about a family that experienced disappointment. Can you hear me? Maybe it's better I use the microphone.
Everybody, is this better? Actually, you are so nice. It may not be better, but is this better? All right, everybody, let's read this together. Now, a certain man was sick, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. It was the Mary who anointed the Lord with ointment, wiped His feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. The sisters therefore sent to Him saying, Lord, behold, he whom You love is sick. Now before I read the next few verses, let me just give you a short background. The Bible tells us, here's this amazing family, Lazarus, Mary, and Martha. And the Bible tells us, for emphasis, the Bible tells us, He whom You love is sick. Who got sick? Lazarus. Now, Lazarus simply means, the Lord is my help. So Lazarus must have come from a godly family because his name is, the Lord is my help. Now, the problem is this. He got sick. And when he got sick, what did Mary, Martha, and the rest do? The sisters sent to him. They sent for Jesus. They were telling Jesus, He whom You love is sick. Now, ladies and gentlemen, let me just share with you I don't know what they did to my PowerPoint, but I'm gonna fix this, okay? I wanted presenter view. It got stuck. Don't worry, if it gets stuck, I'm gonna keep talking. Is that okay with you? Let's read the next verse. When Jesus heard it, he said, "This sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God may be glorified by it." Now, Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. The first thing I like to emphasize is simply this. The Bible tells us Jesus loved Lazarus, not only Lazarus, Jesus loved Martha, her sister, and Lazarus. Why am I emphasizing this? To trust Jesus, to trust God means you must believe He loves you. Our security is not in our love for God. It is in His love for us. Let me repeat. Your security, your confidence is not in your love for God. It is His love for us. The Bible says Jesus loved Lazarus. Except we have theological problem. What's our theological problem? If God loves me, I must not have problems. Most of us have this wrong thinking. If God loves me, why will He allow me to suffer? If God loves me, why will He allow me to get sick? One of the richest men in the States owns a TV network. His sister got sick. But because of wrong theology, because of, you know, some pastors don't teach properly the Bible, or the person, don't blame the pastor, he's not reading the Bible very well. He was led to believe, if I ask God to heal somebody, that person must get well. He was given the impression that God will always heal our sickness. Do you understand what I'm saying? He's very sincere. So he prayed for his sister. The sister did not get well. The sister died. When the sister died, he came up with a conclusion. God is not true. And because God is not true, I will be an atheist. So this guy turned away from Christianity. Friends, what you are about to learn today is crucial. You must understand to trust God means you believe He loves you. Just because He loves you does not exempt you, does not exempt me from problems or sickness. Are we clear so far? I remember teaching these principles years ago. We have this young lady. She was a beauty queen. She came to the Bible study. Then she came to know the Lord. And after coming to know the Lord, she made a decision. Without us telling her, she was living in with a boyfriend. They were rooming in together. But when she met Jesus, she told her boyfriend, "You know what? I cannot continue living in with you. We need to separate." The boyfriend got angry. The boyfriend said, "Who is the man?" The girl said, "Jesus." The boyfriend said, "Well, if it's Jesus, I cannot compete with Him. You may go." Except for one problem. 1 month later, she discovered she was pregnant. I want you to imagine now, a single girl, you have met Jesus, and now you are walking with Him, but you discovered you are pregnant. How would you feel? At that very moment, she has a choice. To keep on trusting God or to turn away from trusting Him. Would you like to know what happened to this girl? Okay. You ask me later. I'm going to tell you. What's the message today? One more time. How do you turn disappointment into blessings? That disappointment became a blessing. But I will tell you how she did it. Okay. The hint is she kept on trusting. She kept on following Jesus. I remembered distinctly, she told my wife, "Who will ever marry me? Who will ever marry me?" It's called buy one, take two. because she has a baby. It's a baggage.
Would you like to know what God did? Okay, later. Make sure you ask me, okay? The Bible tells us, when Jesus heard he was sick, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Yeah, this is something strange. Martha and Mary asked for Jesus to go see Lazarus because Lazarus was sick. The Bible tells us, what did Jesus do? He stayed 2 days longer. Does that make sense? How many of you here are doctors? Okay, well, in some congregation, we have many doctors, okay? In CCF Maine, we're surrounded by doctors. Now, let me tell you something about doctors. When you are sick and you approach them, what do they want to do? Will they go see you immediately? Of course, in the Philippines, we have the best doctors. Filipino doctors are the best. You know why? When you are sick, you call them, they will attend to you. Yes or no? Yes. Well, your doctor tells you, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I want you to put yourself in the shoes of Martha or Mary. Your brother is sick, or your husband is sick, or your child is sick. Doctor, doctor, can you please come? And the doctor will tell you, I'm sorry, I'm busy. When can you come? I really cannot commit. I mean, how would you feel? That's exactly what Jesus did. He did not go. It took him how many days? He stayed 2 days longer. So what does it mean to trust God? To trust God means you must not only believe and trust that He loves you, you must also believe His timing. His timing is perfect. God is never late, but He is never too early. So singles, I remember this single girl telling me, Peter, I've been attending singles retreat for the last 30 years. Relax. God knows what He is doing. Do you believe sometimes it is God's will for you to remain single? Yes or no? If you don't believe me, again, ask those who are married, okay? They may tell you. But praise God, in Christ, marriage is wonderful. Well, let me tell you something about trusting God. Are you willing to trust His timing? How many of you have had unanswered prayers up to now? Your prayers are not yet answered. Raise your hand. Don't be discouraged. Keep praying. I prayed for my father for 20 years, day and night. And after 20 years, my father met Jesus in the most amazing way. I've prayed for people. My encouragement is this. Trust God's timing. Don't give up. Keep praying. Can you tell your neighbor? Don't give up. Keep trusting. You see, waiting is part of the process of becoming what God wants us to be. It's part of God's way of transforming us. So learn to wait. Singles, huh? Singles, wave at me. Keep waiting, okay? Keep waiting. Jesus, therefore, said to them plainly, Lazarus is dead. I am glad for your sakes that I was not there so that you may believe, but let us go. In other words, Jesus waited. To trust God, you must believe He loves you. You must believe His timing is perfect, but you must also believe He knows what He's doing. You know, this is crazy. The Bible tells us Jesus waited, and then by the time He went there, would you like to know what happened? Let's read this. When Jesus came, He found that He had been dead in the tomb. How many days? 4 days. My goodness. Dead. Why will a doctor see the patient when the patient is dead? Do you know the Tagalog description of somebody who is dead 4 days already? I teach you. It's called patay na patay. I'm glad you still understand Tagalog, okay? It's called dead, dead. Now, remember, God wants you to learn something. When you're disappointed, what can be worse than encountering death? It's the end. For human beings, that's the worst disappointment in life. It's gone. It's finished. Dead. Yes or no? What is God trying to tell us today? You see, it's so important that you understand who God is. God wants you to know today, He loves you. Do you believe He loves you? Sometimes I doubt. But when I think of the cross, how Jesus died on the cross in my place, I say, Lord, I thank you, you love me. But are you willing to believe that even though God loves you, He does not always answer your prayer based on your timing? His timing is His prerogative. You don't dictate to Him because He knows what is best. What about His wisdom? The Bible tells us He waited 4 days. My goodness, 4 days. There's a Jewish tradition, rumor, Jewish myth, that when somebody dies, the spirit is still around, hovering. 1 day, still around. 2 days, spirit still around. You know, the twilight zone. After 3 days, the spirit is still around. But on the 4th day, the spirit lives. Now, I don't know if that's part of their belief, but Jesus made sure when He arrived, Lazarus is patay na patay. Dead, dead. Jesus made sure. Guess what happened next? Well, before I tell you what happened next, I want you to learn to trust God. Do you notice there are times in your life things does not make sense? And you question Him like our sister, the baby died. I mean, it does not make sense. Why did God have to wait until 3-4 days before birth? The baby will die. Honestly, in my experiences, many times I don't understand. I have a business friend. After Bible study, he gave his life to Jesus. He met the Lord. After meeting the Lord, he came to me. After 1 year, he said, Peter, I got a problem. Before I met the Lord, my business was booming. After I met the Lord, my business began to go down. How do you advise somebody? Before I met the Lord, I don't have money problem. My business was moving, booming. Now that I met the Lord, how come my business is going down? How do you counsel somebody like that? I will tell you how. You look at him. I want to pray for you. Sometimes I don't know what to say. I told him, I don't always understand why, but just keep trusting. Everybody say that with me. Keep trusting. Would you like to know what happened to this guy? Would you like to know? Okay. Tell you later. But I'd like you to know one thing. The Bible tells us in Isaiah 55, everybody please read this. My thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, my thoughts than your thoughts. What God is saying in simple English is simply this. My IQ is higher than your IQ. That's what God is saying. As the heavens are higher than the earth, are my ways higher than your ways, my thoughts, your thoughts. How high is the heaven above the earth? How high? How high? What God is saying is simply this, in simple English. My intelligence, my ways, is higher than your intelligence, than your ways. Because our IQ compared to God is only like this. Okay, let me prove to you how intelligent you are. Okay? Would you like me to give you some tests? The Lord's ways are higher than your ways? Okay. How many of you understand quantum physics? You don't even know how to spell quantum. Now, they've discovered in quantum physics about light. Is light particle or is light wave? See, during my days, light is particle. And then they discovered it's not particle. They discovered it's wave. And then they finally changed their mind. They said light is both wave and particle. Do you understand what I'm talking about? Of course not. You know why? Your IQ is... Really? DNA. Do you know what is DNA? Just to pronounce the deoxyribonucleic, blah, 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 blah. You know, guys, do you understand DNA in every cell is almost what? 2 meters long, if you were to stretch it out? Every single human body has DNA. If you were to stretch it out, will go to the sun and back 58 times. Oh, do you understand that? Of course not. Because your IQ and... Just like me. You know, honestly, I don't understand a lot of things. I don't understand. However, God is saying, you trust me. It takes humility to trust God. And I trust God based on track record. Because the Bible tells us, Jesus died on the cross and rose again. Why is that important? Let's find out. Let's look at what happened to Mary and Martha. Let's read this together, everybody. Martha, therefore, when she heard that Jesus was coming, went to meet him, but Mary sat in the house. Martha said to Jesus, everybody read. Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. If. What is if in Tagalog? Kung. Do you know many of us live with this word, kung? If only I did not marry you. No. Just be careful. I'm just giving example. If. You know what? If is living in the past. If is focusing on what has happened in the past. And my friend, listen to me. Do not blame the past. Do not blame yourself. But the truth is Satan wants you to live in the past. Kung. Yes or no? I remember what happened to a girl in Arrowhead Spring. This is Campus Crusade for Christ years ago. I think Jim, you remember the story. This girl was engaged to be married. They had this Friday night gathering, wedding day Saturday. That night, as she was going home, her fiancé was going to drive her. She told her fiancé, let me drive. I will drive because after you get married, you will always drive for me. While she was driving, they met a fatal accident. The fiancé died on the spot. She could not forgive herself. She was taking sleeping pills, medicine, to solve her hypertension, her inability to sleep. One day, she went to see Dr. Bill Bright, the founder of Campus Crusade for Christ. She was so troubled. You know what Dr. Bill Bright told her? Have you ever thanked the Lord for the death of your fiancé? She looked at him with horror. How can I thank the Lord? And this is where Dr. Bill Bright, I was there when I heard the story. When you thank God, you are saying, Lord, I trust you. I don't understand, but I trust you. Thank you. You see, the Bible says, in everything, give thanks. Faith, trust, is thanking God for everything. The good and the bad. Are you thanking the Lord for everything? See, some of us don't thank the Lord. You have bitterness. You have anger. Because you have not understood what it means to trust God. That girl, with tears in her eyes, said, okay, I'm going to trust the Lord. That night, in her room, she cried. She said, Lord, I don't understand, but I'm going to trust you. The next morning, she went to see Dr. Bright. She said, for the first time in my life. After the accident, I slept like a baby. She was healed immediately. Friends, faith in God, trusting God, allows you to experience supernatural power. Look at what Martha said. If you had been here, my brother would not have died. Many times we blame God. Lord, if you did this, if you did that. Well, my point is this. Trust is trusting God's love for us, trusting His timetable, amen, trusting His wisdom. But you keep trusting Him. And how do you trust Him? Thank Him for everything. The root of all sin is the suspicion that God is not good. And that's the problem with many believers. Something happened to you, to your family, and you believe in your heart God is not good. My friend, that's from the devil. Is God good? Louder, is God good? All the time. My friend, is God good? All the time. All the time? You know, sometimes it's not easy to say that. Many years ago, 25 years ago, our daughter, when she was 15 years old, was raped. Not raped by one man, but by seven men. I don't know about you fathers, but for me, the worst thing that can ever happen to a father is his inability to protect his daughter. I was in a Bible study on a Friday night when a tragedy happened. I remember that distinctly. When I got home, I saw all the police cars, all the light. I told my wife, something horrible happened. I thought my children were dead. When I entered the house, my goodness, it's like a hurricane went through. They robbed the house and they did bad things. I never cried more in my life because I could not understand why a loving God would allow an innocent 15-year-old daughter who has never kissed a man, who was holy, who was pure. And our family, we were serving the Lord. I was really disturbed. But I have to apply theology. In my heart, I know that God is good. In my heart, I know God loves her, that God loves us, and that God wants me to trust Him. You know, my daughter and our family claim this verse. Let's read this together. We know that God causes all things to work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to His purpose. Notice what the Bible says. We know, not we see. Sometimes you don't see, but this is a statement of faith. We know God causes all things to work for good. He does not cause bad things, but He can allow the bad things to become good. You better understand this properly. God can cause bad things to become good. Are we communicating clearly? We know that, one more time, God causes all things to work together for good to those who, there's a condition, how you respond. You cannot love somebody if you don't trust that person. So the presumption here is you love God because you trust Him. But we don't understand the meaning of good. What is this good? The Bible tells us, to those who are called according to His purpose. Now, what is the good that God is going to cause in the midst of trial and pain? Like what happened to that girl who got pregnant when she decided to follow God. What happened to that business friend of mine who gave his life to Jesus and he began to suffer financially. What happened to our family when we committed our lives to serve Him and that bad incident happened. What good will come out of this? Many times, I'm going to tell you right now, you may not know why. But my job is to believe that God causes all things to work together for what? For good. It will eventually good, become good. How many of you love adobo? Adobo. Chicken and pork adobo. I tell you, I miss those food already, okay? You know, I'm not a cook, but to cook adobo for my friends who are in Canada, if you don't know, you have to mix different ingredients, right? You mix what? Honey, pepper, what else? Garlic, what else? Suka. In other words, those condiments by itself may not taste good, but you mix them up together. After a while, yummy, yummy. Yes? In your life, certain things happen. And it is not good. It's painful. But when you allow God to mold your life, pretty soon, you will say it's good. Now, what is the good here? Would you like to know the good? What's the verse after verse 28? What verse? 29. Smart. You guys are smart. Now, what is verse 29? Tell me, what is verse 29? My friend, the problem of Christianity today is Bible illiteracy. We don't know the Bible. If you don't know the Word of God, how can you trust God? How many of you know verse 29? Raise your hand. Be honest with me. How many of you don't know verse 29? So that I will show you. Raise your hand, then I will show you. All right, I'm glad you humbled yourselves. I challenge you, please, read the Bible, okay? Our leadership, including myself, my family, we read the Bible once every year. The entire Bible every year. You know why? I want to know the Lord. Look at verse 29. Those whom he foreknew, he predestined to become conformed to the image of his son. You see, when God allows problems, he's conforming your character. He's doing something. Because your character is eternal. Your physical comfort is temporal. What is more important? Eternity or temporal here? Eternity. The Bible says he's transforming our character. We were created in the image of God. But sin destroyed it. God is saying, now I'm going to work in your life to make you Christ-like. You know, Martha said, I know he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day. Jesus said to her, everybody read, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me shall live even if he dies. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? Jesus was going to use the death of Lazarus to teach them an amazing spiritual lesson. And what is that lesson? Jesus said, everybody read, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me shall live even if he dies. Everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Friends, if you have a Savior who cannot do anything about death, forget it. Let me repeat. The reality is this. If Jesus cannot do anything about death, then whatever else he can do is nothing. Any Savior that cannot do anything about death is a useless Savior. But I praise God for Jesus. Jesus wanted Mary and Martha and the entire discipleship team and the whole world to know that he is the resurrection and the life. Amazing claim. I have studied world religion. These are the major religion of the world. Hinduism, Buddhism, Islam, Christianity. Major religions of the world. The only one that makes amazing claim is the founder of Christianity. Jesus said, I am. Please read, I am the resurrection and the life. My goodness. Either that is true or not true. If it is not true, forget Christianity. You know why? That's a statement of a crazy guy. But if it is true, bow down to Jesus. Let me repeat. If Jesus is not the resurrection and the life, he's making a false claim. And anybody who makes a false claim is a liar. And you and I should not waste time with this kind of religion. And let me tell you, Jesus Christ wanted the disciples to know who he is. How can you and I trust Jesus if we don't know who he is? So Jesus said one more time, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me shall live even if he dies. Friends, can you now understand church history? Why the secular historians, when they wrote what happened to first century Christians, how they were burned, how they were fed to the lions, and how they died smiling, how they would not deny the resurrection of Jesus, and all they have to do is to bow down to Caesar, and they will be saved. But they were martyred. They were killed for their confession that Jesus died and rose again from the dead. Either Christianity is true or it is not true. If Christianity is not true, forget about it. But Christianity can never be moderately important if it is true. Let me repeat. If Christianity is true, it cannot be moderately important. It is the most important thing in your life. If it is not true, friends, forget it. I don't even know why you want to be here on a Sunday. For me, I believe Jesus died and rose again. Because that's how he proved he's the resurrection and the life. First, by what happened to Lazarus. Look at what he did. Everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this promise? Let's find out. When Jesus therefore saw her weeping and the Jews who came with her weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and was troubled and said, where have you laid him? They said to Jesus, Lord, come and see. Jesus wept. John 11:35. By the way, you want to impress your parents or not? You tell your parents, I memorized the verse. The shortest verse in the Bible. Jesus wept. John 11:35. Now, you may laugh at this verse, but to me it's very profound. You know why it's so profound? It tells me that my Savior understands. It tells me that God knows your struggle today. It tells me that God feels what you feel. God is not somebody up there without any emotion. The reason why you have emotion is because you and I are created in the image of God. The reason you love is because God is love. The reason why you hate injustice is because God is just. The reason why we believe in fairness is because you believe there is some truth about the reality. There has to be a better place than this earth. My friend, Jesus wept. Some of you feel so lonely. That's what I heard from the TV commentator about this guy, Anthony. He was with the friends, but he was lonely. Many people are lonely today. And I believe God will use you to reach out to people. Jesus wants to be your friend. He wants to be your Savior. But you will not encounter him until you humble yourself. Look at what happened here. Jesus, therefore, being deeply moved within, came to the tomb. It was a cave. A stone was laying against it. Everybody read this. Jesus said, remove the stone. Martha, the sister of the deceased, said, Lord, by this time there will be a stench, for he has been dead. How many days? 4 days. Everybody, what did Jesus say? Remove the stone. Now, let me ask you, why did Jesus have to command Martha, Mary, and all of those people there, remove the stone? Why? And why will Martha said, Lord, why will we move the stone? It's going to be smelly. Friends, what is the meaning of trust? The meaning of trust is obedience. When you trust God, you demonstrate that by obedience. Many people say they believe. If you believe, but you don't act on your belief, it's not yet belief. Look, you know what Jesus said? Did I not say to you, if you believe, you will see the glory of God? This is an amazing principle. Believe first, and you will see the glory of God. Can I tell you about us? We say, let me see first before I believe. Yes or no? From now on, you're learning today, believe first and see the glory of God. So what do I mean? I told that girl, believe in Jesus. Trust Him. I told that businessman, believe, trust Jesus, and see. You know what happened to that girl? Are you ready? That girl kept on trusting the Lord. She kept on believing in Jesus. In fact, she was part of our small group. But would you believe it? In her mind, how will she ever marry again? God orchestrated amazing events. This girl met a man who loved her as Israel is. Would you believe it? They are now the pastor of one of the biggest satellites of CCF. Is God amazing? Can I tell you why? Because God will use her pain to encourage other women. You know, God will use your failures. He will use your past to be a blessing, provided you're willing to allow Him. And you will only allow Him if you keep trusting. Keep trusting means keep on obeying. You know what happened to the businessman? Would you like to know? Well, that business friend of mine, after 3 years, came back to see me. He said, Peter, you won't believe this. God has blessed me so much financially. I said, what happened to you? He said, remember I told you, you know, that business that went down, God took it away. And by taking it away, He replaced me with a better business. And my business today is so much better. You see, sometimes God takes away in order to replace it. So singles, if your boyfriend leaves you, if your girlfriend leaves you, what do you say? Hallelujah! Because God has somebody better. That's my own experience. When God takes away something, be ready. He has something better. But I asked him, Pare, what was your business before? He said, technical smuggling. Oh, I said, my goodness. Technical smuggling. He will bring in cars, you know, these chop-chop cars, you know, and they reassemble them. I said, how in the world do you expect God to bless you? How can you give a testimony in front of CCF? You know, God has blessed me financially. My business is so good. I don't business more. Technical smuggling. Anyway, the Bible tells us, move thy stone. So they removed thy stone. When they removed thy stone, guess what happened? When he had said these things, he cried out with a loud voice. When he had said these things, he cried out with a loud voice. What was the loud voice? Lazarus, come forth. He who had died came forth, bound hand and foot with wrappings, and his face was wrapped around with a cloth. Jesus said to them, unbind him, let him go. The impossible happened. Somebody dead for 4 days came back to life. Now let me ask you a question. Is it easier for Jesus to move the stone? Or is it easier to make the dead come back to life? Which one is harder? To make the dead come back to life or to move the stone? Which is harder? To make the dead come back to life or to move the stone? Which is harder? To make the dead come back to life. You don't believe me? You try. But why did Jesus not move the stone when it's easy for him to move the stone? Why did he ask the people to move the stone before he would ask Lazarus to come out? Why? Here's the principle. Trust involves obedience. Until you obey, many times you will never see what God can do. Let me repeat. Many of us do not know what God can do in your life, through your life, because of unbelief. There are certain things in life you will never know. it's only after you obey, you will know. In the case of my daughter, our family, because our daughter did not develop bitterness, our family had no bitterness. Today, as I look back, my daughter today is probably one of the best counselors when it comes to abuse women. She wrote an amazing book, A Good God, When a Good God Allows Rape. How many of you have seen that book? When a Good God Allows Rape. She has appeared on TV. She has spoken all over the world. She would not have experienced what God can do in and through her if she did not surrender her experience to the Lord. Our family, the entire CCF family, would not have gone through this amazing reality that God's people can have problems. But in the midst of problem, you can not only just survive, you can thrive. On one condition, what must you do? Trust Him. But you cannot trust Him if you don't know Him. You know, many scholars and Christians like to say this. Jesus had to shout, Lazarus, come forth. Can I tell you why? If Jesus did not use the name Lazarus, all the dead would have come back to life. Such is the authority of our Savior. And the Bible tells us someday He's going to call you. Someday when He comes again. When the trumpet will sound, will you hear His voice? The Bible says the dead in Christ will come forth. All of us. Provided you hear His voice. The problem is this. Some of us will not hear His voice. Some of us here will not be given the opportunity to experience what Lazarus experienced. Is Jesus your Savior? Don't answer me now. Ask yourself. How do you know Jesus is your Savior? Have you surrendered your whole life to Him? When He asks you to move the stone, have you moved the stone? Or will you move the stone? There are many stones in our lives. The stone of unbelief. For some of you, it is a relationship. A sinful relationship. That God is saying, get rid of it. But you don't want to move it. And God is saying, you move it. The Bible says, believe and you see the glory of God. Until you do your part, I want to tell you something. You won't experience the amazing things that God can do in your life, through your life. Because certain things, let me repeat, you will not experience and you will never know until you obey. Many years ago, my wife left the beautiful shore of San Francisco to come to the Philippines. She never knew what would happen. My wife left the Philippines serving the Lord. But today, if you ask my wife, she has seen amazing numbers of people whose lives have been transformed. My wife would not have known how God would use her to start a home education movement in Asia. You may not understand, our home education movement today is blessed by God. We have over, 3,000 students right now? Our home education school movement, you have people in the Middle East, America, all over the world, enrolled in home educational program. And my daughter, Joy, and her husband, Edric, is the one heading that home education movement. What God can do in and through somebody who is willing to trust Him. Has God been speaking to you? You know, the Bible tells us, as we close, let's read this. Therefore, many of the Jews who came to Mary saw what He had done. And what happened? They believed in Jesus. Do you know God wants to use your life to help others believe Him? Do you know that even your failures, even your pain, God will use it? So whatever problems you may have, you can turn disappointment into blessings. On what condition? Trust. How do you trust Him? You thank Him. You obey Him. How do you trust Him? Believe He loves you. How do you trust Him? Trust His timing. How do you trust Him? Trust His wisdom. How do you trust Him? Believe He knows what He's doing. Only God, everybody read this, only God can turn a mess into a message, a test into a testimony, a trial into a triumph, a victim into a victor, a disappointment into a blessing. Let's bow our heads. If God has spoken to you, and today you want to make sure that you will hear the voice of Jesus someday, that you will have eternal life because He died on the cross and rose again, I want to pray for you. You want to turn over your life completely to Him. You want to trust Him. Will you raise your hands? Praise God. Higher. You want to surrender your disappointment. You want to turn whatever is holding you back. There's a stone in your life and you are now willing to move it. I want to pray for you. Raise your hands. Praise God. There's a stone in your life, or stones, and God is asking you, move it. And you have not been moving it. And the reason you have not been moving it, because you are afraid. Ladies and gentlemen, of course, sometimes we are afraid to obey. But I want you to trust Him more than to trust your fear. Trust God more. Raise your hands. If there are stones in your life you need to move, perhaps one of them will be the stone of unbelief. Anybody else? Keep those hands up higher. Between you and the Lord. You don't have to look for other people. Between you and the Lord, I praise God for many of you. Those of you who have raised your hands up, right now, wherever you are, I want you to pray this prayer with me. Pray this prayer with me. Lord Jesus, I surrender my life to You. I move the stone. Whatever that is, You tell Jesus right now. What is it God wants you to do that you are not yet doing? You tell Him right now that you will move it out of your life. And Lord Jesus, give me the strength to do what You want me to do. Lord Jesus, I want to be sure that I belong to You. Today, I invite You personally as my Lord and my Savior. Forgive me when I doubt You. Forgive me when I question Your wisdom in my life. But Lord, in the midst of pain, in the midst of disappointment, I trust You. I don't know the outcome, but I will trust You. The one day You will make it clear. Those of you who raise your hands, will you stand up? I'm going to say a special prayer. Yes, stand up. The Bible says, you make a stand for Jesus. Today you want to make a public profession. Wherever you are, stand up. Praise God. Now, some of you, I know God is asking you to surrender your life. But you're struggling. You don't want to surrender. Don't resist that voice. Stand up. You know why? God's voice is amazing. He does not stop. He wants you to surrender. Yes, I know some of you are struggling, but stand up for Him. Anybody else? Yes, praise God. Praise God, Lord. Praise God. Anybody else? Yes. I know God is always at work. Many years ago, I did the same thing. I stood up. And my life was forever changed. When you stand up, you are simply saying, Lord, here I am. Anybody else? Praise God. Lord Jesus, I now pray for this group of men and women who have stood up. Make Yourself very real. You have promised us that if we believe, we will see the glory of God. Forgive us when we say, see first before we believe. So Lord, I pray for everybody here that have stood up. You know their struggles. You know their pain. But Father God, as they trust You, Make yourself intimate. Make yourself real. Let them experience amazing things that can only come from you. Bless them individually, their family. In Jesus' name we all pray, amen and amen. God bless you.
All things work for a good. Sometimes we can't see how they could. Struggles to break our hearts into. Sometimes blind us to. Father knows what's best for us. His ways are not our own. So when your pathway goes dim and you just can't see Him, remember you're never alone. God is too wise to be mistaken. When you don't see His plan, when you can't trace His hand, trust His heart. He sees the master plan. He holds the future in His hand. So don't leave us those who see the present clearly. He sees the first and the last. Like a tapestry, He's weaving you and me to someday be just like Him. God is too wise to be His heart, and He alone is faithful and true, and He alone knows what is best for you. And God is too wise to be mistaken. God is too good to be unkind. So when you don't understand, when you can't see His plan, when you can't trace His hand, trust His heart. And when you can't trace His hand, trust His heart.